Hello.
Good afternoon.
Thank you all for being here. I'm here to present on a project that I've been working on the last year. Actually, a friend is one of those aspects of the project. A couple of years ago, when I was in art school, I became very much interested in this idea that painting as a known form could be expanded through like an architectural manner or something. In Ghana, throughout the 20th century, we had a lot of artists who did really incredible works, but because there was that lack of infrastructure, a lot of artists, mostly who were painters, only had to make painting in the genre that we knew it to be. So if it was making painting on a canvas, they would reduce the canvas down to a size which would fit into the building, as in looking at hotel spaces and like small cultural institutes and other spaces which existed. In 2012, when I was doing my MFA, I came across this material, which is the burlap jute sacks. In Ghana, it is primarily used in transporting commodities, mostly cocoa. But the interesting thing about the material is that it's not produced in Ghana, it's produced in Southeast Asia. So when it's brought to Ghana, the company that brings it is the Cocoa Board, which buys these materials, and then they also buy like the commodities from the farmers, which they then bag it with the cocoa beans, which are then transported to America, Europe, or any other place. But the bags remain. So when the bags are left behind, the bags are not used to bag cocoa again because of insect infestations and other fungus and other things. So then small-scale farming people who farm rice, maize, and other things, use these materials then to bag their produce. But the interesting thing is that once it's used to bag rice, maize, and other things, because it's not as valuable as cocoa on the world markets, which the value which they place on cocoa, they tend to write all sorts of things on the bag. So the bag almost becomes like a living thing, and it starts to actually represent the conditions which are somehow embodied within the labor forms that goes into the production of these things. Because come to think of it, when you go to Starbucks or any other place to buy cocoa, you don't necessarily think about the labor that goes into the production of it, you know? So sometimes politically, we think that the commodities may be might more valuable than the bodies that produce those things. So I somehow started thinking about the relationship between the commodities in relation to the objects which in turn these bags. So the work in Milan, a friend, was actually actualized last year in a collaboration with the Trussardi Foundation, which was curated by the director of the new museum here in New York, Massimiliano Gioni. And the idea was somehow to take these two historical buildings in Milan. They are called Porto di Venezia, which originally used to be these gates that you would actually go through centuries ago in order to get to Milan. But over time, of course, the city has grown, so you find that there are like all kinds of like neighborhoods surrounding these monuments. So, and also in the time of crisis, looking at issues of migration and the idea of the other, the inside versus the outside, I think it was really important to somehow think about the relationship between these materials in relation to the historical nature of this building. It was quite controversial because there are a lot of people in Milan who said, oh, but this is not art, or why are they covering this monumental historical building with these dirty rags, and how is it important to think about the idea of the so-called other in relation to Italian history and blah, blah, blah. But I think that's the kind of work that I like to do, like to create work that somehow seems out of place. So these are also fueled by historical sites. So this building is one of the many silos that were built in Ghana during the Cold War by Eastern European architects in relation to our then president. The idea of storing these commodities, which Ghana at the time in the 50s was the highest producer of cocoa in the world. Now we and Ivory Coast actually produce like 70% of the world's cocoa. But because of the lack of factories and like processing plants, this was one of the processing plants, but it somehow failed within the time, because the idea that if it had been realized, it would have somehow created a new point of negotiation between Africa and Europe. So I like to go back to that history again and again, but looking at it not just from a historical point of view, but one, architecturally, and second, also looking at it artistically and from a geometrical point. So a lot of the work actually involves buying these old materials, which somehow seem very dead and embodied with all the failures and crises of history, and then also the spaces around. So on the image on the left, you have one of the railway stations, which was built by the British in the late 19th century, and then also a bridge, which was built around 1932 by Germany. So the idea that the artist studio could be very open and somehow the work that is produced could be affected by the residues within those spaces became something important. So this is the National Theatre in Ghana. So I became very much obsessed with the idea of creating work that seemed out of the traditional exhibition space. So it could be like a building, and all these buildings are in use actually when I produce the works. And they are produced with very intense labor forms. So I borrow all these labor forms from different communities, and also like practices and all that. Historically, the subject matter would be something depicted, which would be maybe within the art form which exists in the museum, but the idea that it's something that somehow becomes part of the community or the public is important. So this was a work in a documenter 2 years ago, these two historical buildings, which used to be also the gates into the city. So the work has taken many different forms because I tend to be very interested in old decaying objects, boxes, posters, shoes. It could be anything, parts of buildings. These were exhibitions that I did both in London and in Brazil a couple of years ago. So the question was that, you know, fundamentally as an artist, you spend all this time of your life traveling around the world, doing mega exhibitions and then getting all these shows. But fundamentally, when you think about it in the long run, it doesn't really do anything, to be honest with you. As an artist, you can spend your entire life doing one exhibition after the other. But particularly coming from where I come from, we don't have these institutions that do exist. So, for instance, as a Ghanaian artist, even if I use an artist like maybe Ella Natri, who is one of the greatest artists we've ever had, I would never see a work of him in Ghana or even on the continent. I would have to come to America in order to see his work, you know? So these are questions that are very realistic to look at. And in my work, I've been looking at the contradictions of capital and what it does. And I produce a lot of work with materials which seem very obsolete. But there is something really interesting about capital and what it does. Through art, when you produce things, that thing called, that magical thing, which transforms the work into a commodity which goes into an institution. But then when it produces something like money, what do you do with it? So I almost think of it as material. The money then now becomes something else which you can use. So in 2015, I started purely looking at how we could generate spaces within the communities that I come from, which never existed to begin with. So I started building like these institutional spaces, using the models of the railway stations and all these old abandoned factories, which were used in the post-independence period and also within our colonial history, but had the spirits of the presentation of contemporary arts and ideas and thoughts, because of the idea of making things on larger scales, which were used for for certain kinds of exploitations. So the building that you see is the space that I built from 2014 to last year, 19, when it opened, called the Savannah Center for Contemporary Art, where it's dedicated mostly to modern art, artists who've practiced in the 20th century, but their works were never really recognized because we didn't have those infrastructures to begin with. And it's also important somehow to build spaces which help in the longer run to transform the way children think, one, about their ideological values within the spaces they come from, and two, also just to give them a different sense of perspective in terms of the way the world operates and production systems and all that. So we center the activities within the space for workshops, painting, drawing. We have a library, public library, that we give access to schools, and we do reading sessions and all kinds of things. So these are just images of, and traditionally, it's, so where this is centered is in the northern part of Ghana. So geographically and also just economically, it's a lot more poorer. And also it's much drier. So a lot of things that grow in the south don't really grow there, but we have specific things like maize, yam, and other things that grow there. So, and agriculture is the predominant form of work there. So I like the idea that an Islamic society as it is, in a way that normally people would say, if people are poor, and also much particularly when they come from an Islamic community, the idea of looking at works that are in much more figurative sense, didn't make any, like, wasn't feasible. And first of all, you have to solve the economics. Yes, it's important. The work that I do actually focuses on the idea of the economics, because you cannot really address art until you look much deeper into, like, economic disparities and all that. So I started going into architectural forms, working with engineers to look at soil types within the region and how these materials could be used in the production of bricks, which is not really used in the place, but it's actually the thing that should be used because of the temperatures and all that, to create and expand the institution and create new spaces. So these are some of the ideas for my notebooks. So looking at the idea of land and negotiating with chiefs, because the state doesn't really own land. And when you buy land, you own the land, but you don't own anything that is on the land. So you could be in your house and someone could come and cut a tree within your house because they would tell you you didn't plant the tree. But it's that idea that the spaces that we have somehow belong to a community. So I started looking at the idea of developing this infrastructure, this studio space. So I started collecting all kinds of other materials like airplanes, trains, things that could actually be very transformative in a way that children could interact with these spaces. Because come to think of it, if you're doing drawing workshops in a traditional room, it's something that is ordinary. But when it's in an aircraft space, which is transformed, which is somehow you place VR games and other things, I think it goes a really long way. And particularly in a community that seems almost to be, because the states wouldn't really be interested in creating a space like this in the middle of nowhere. But I think as artists, that is one thing that makes us distinct, that we have a responsibility, and also we are always willing to start from zero, I think, because it's not based on any capital. So one of the things that I focus on is creating all these spaces, both for collections and all that. There are works which I've done. The last project I did in Manchester called the Parliament of Ghosts, which I used train seats from the railways, the history of the railways, and cabinets to create all these social areas. The idea was to build it permanently as part of the land in Tamale. Because then you think of it, people will say, but why don't you create it in a center, in a place where people can access it? Like, the people in this village will not really understand. But no one is really dumb. And I believe that when you give people the opportunity or create things in spaces, it actually goes a long way in a way that it transforms that community, and particularly the children who are growing to grow within that space. Yeah, so these are just images of it. So I like the idea that you could combine these mechanics, planes, together with buildings that are built from scratch in relation to agriculture, because it's a big area. So I collected these aircraft, and the idea of working with ordinary people, truck drivers, engineers, farmers, in a way of moving these kinds of objects which ordinarily would seem out of place. And it's not something that you see all the time. And I think that it's something that I'm much more focused on in my work, the idea of using the very ordinary and then making it very complicated and then disseminate it in a very simple way. So these are images of some of the trains and historical images, archives of how these things were transported and how they can be transformed looking at the current nature and conditions of them. Yeah, so these are some of the spaces. So the idea that you could, so this is one of the airplane spaces, which was an aircraft which was going to be scrapped, which I saved. So the idea that these spaces, which almost looks like the inner intestines of any living thing, in relation to, let's say, a building which is being built up, which can somehow transform and take the form of anything, I think it's very important. And in the longer run, if artists think about that, particularly from spaces where they come from, and create things that are transformative, it will go a longer way to somehow create new, a generation of new thinkers rather than what we are currently. Thank you.